So I'm going to first take a look at BD. Again, it has to be a right triangle. So I'm going to sketch a straight line here. And this is for the member BD. And I am looking for this right triangle for BD. I'm going to start with the easier one here. What is the height for this triangle?
Six.
Six. Very good. Then what about the base? Now remember yesterday. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I said three.
Very good. How did you get three, Dailene?
Well, I think I kind of cut you off. Yesterday, Monday, we determined the bigger base was eight. So I subtract from five.
Very good. So what Dailene is saying is this, from point A to B, B is right here, right? For my triangle, the height is 8 feet. But from A to D is 5 feet. So if this whole thing is 8, then this remaining, oh no, I should not have drawn that over that. Then this right, where's my pen? This right here should be 3. By subtracting 5 from 8, we get 3. Or you could have looked at 7 feet as well. On Monday, we determined that this distance here is 4 feet. Therefore, subtracting 4 from 7 will give you 3. So there is more than one way of doing it, right? So we got 6. I'm looking for the hypotenuse, and this gives me 6.7082 square. So for the force in member BD, we have 6.7082. Getting a little crowded, so that's why I like to show my math to the side, away from everything. Now let's take a look at your AB. I'm going to go back up to the top. Now for AB, again, it has to be a right triangle. Here is my hypotenuse for AB. Notice what I'm doing here, going straight down, going across. This is for my AB. Again, what is the height? I read your lips, Dailene. 6, very good. Okay, now what about the base?
8.
Very good. It's from A to B. Okay, so we got 8 square plus 6 square giving us 10. That one is a simple triangle. So, but I will still write it here. 8 square plus 6 square gives you 10 square. So we got 8, 6, 10. Very good. Now we are ready to apply our equations of equilibrium. We have two unknowns at this joint, which is fine because we have two equations. Let me ask you the following question, because these are the questions that you should be asking. I have two unknowns with two equations. Which equation do you think I should use first?
Fx.
Sum of the forces in the x equal to 0, y. Jason?
Good question.
How about this? Let me help you here. How many unknown forces do we have in the x?
Two.
Two. Very good. How many unknown forces do we have in the Y?
Also two.
Also two, very good. I think that was tied, very good. So Jason says, start with sum of the forces in the X equal to zero because it doesn't matter in this case. We have the same amount, same number of unknowns in both X and Y. So in this case, it makes no difference. So Jason, you're right. We're going to start with sum of the forces in the x equal to zero. Why not, right? So there is no real advantage of starting with one equation over the other in this case. I'm going to start from the left and move to the right. So I'm going to start with my f sub ab. When this force is resolved, using my assumed sense, it's moving to the right, so positive f sub ab times 8 over 10. That's my x component. Moving to f sub bd, according to the assumed sense, the x component of the force is moving to the left, so negative f sub bd times 3 over 6.7082. F sub BC is moving to the negative side. So negative F sub BC, where the magnitude of this force is known because we found it, times 4 over 7.211. And finally, don't forget about the two kips, minus 2. I'm going to leave out the unit. Equal to zero. I like to always clean up a little bit before I carry out the math. F sub AB has a coefficient of 0.8. We like that because that one is pretty simple. F sub BD, its coefficient is using four decimal places. I get 0.4472. F sub BC, we found this before, 0.8013 kips. Times its coefficient of 0.5547 minus 2 kips equal to 0. Now notice that we have two unknown forces here and two known forces. So I'm going to go ahead and combine the two known forces. Unknowns remains unknown. So mathematically or algebraically, I am stuck because I got one equation with two unknowns. So I'm just going to have to leave this the way it is and then come back to it. But let's move down to, let me see, make sure you guys have this down. Okay. Okay, Tawana is looking up, good, okay. Okay, Bobby, are you good or are you writing? Good, okay, because I'm gonna scroll down. Oh, I don't have enough room. Maybe I cannot scroll down too far. Okay, now I'm gonna carry out my next equation, sum of the forces in the Y. I know my picture is above, so please refer to your free body diagram so that I don't have to scroll back and forth disrupting it. Again, I'm gonna start with AB. It's going up, so positive, 6 over 10. F sub BD is coming down, so minus. BC is going up, so positive. Again, F sub BC has been determined for us. So I'm basically cleaning up some of the math here. To find an empty space. Okay, let me know when you guys have this. Look up. Okay, very good. Now notice what we have here. We got two of the same unknowns in this equation versus the equation above, right? So mathematically, if you find yourselves in this mathematical situation, what would you do? I have two equations with two unknowns.
Solve for one unknown and plug into the other equation?
Sure, you guys can use substitution. Or what is our other method?
Elimination.
Sure, by using simultaneous equations or system of equations, okay? So I'm gonna do the systems of equations because I think that one's a little bit more difficult with you guys. So I'm going to take, I gotta find an empty page. Okay, let me just jump to here. So let me just quickly rewrite my equations here. I'm gonna bring down my first one. Let me just rewrite the equations. You guys can just continue from the last equation that we found from some of the forces in the Y. I'm just gonna rewrite it here because I don't have space. And then I'm gonna bring down the one that I highlighted in blue before from the first and line them up nicely. It's usually in algebra that students make mistakes. Okay, so I have them lined up one after another, and I'm going to use, let me use a different color. So Dylene says we should eliminate one of the two unknowns. I think just by looking at their coefficients, it's easier to eliminate f sub ab. So I'm just gonna go ahead and multiply f sub ab, the top one, by the coefficient of positive 0.8. Whereas for the bottom one, I'm going to multiply it by negative 0.6. So for the top one, I get 0.48. times f sub ab. Now don't forget to carry out the distribution for the entire equation. And we're going to add these two equations. Okay, so if you're looking at these two equations, notice that your f sub ab cancels out nicely, right? Gone. And then here I got 0.4472 times f sub bd plus 2 kit. Oh, that doesn't look good. Now solving for f sub bd, we get 4.4723 kips. My answer came out as positive, which means that my assumed sense is correct. So looking at your free body diagram, I don't need to update it. So what can we conclude about this member BD? Is this under compression or is this under tension?
Tension.
Very good. So capital letter T. That one's done, right? But we're not quite done with this joint. We had two unknowns. So I gotta go back up to my first equation. You guys are done over here because I need to go back up. Okay. Let me go back up here. Back to my first equation. And I have to make my substitution. So I got F sub AB times 0.8 minus F sub BD, we just found it. 4.4723 kips times the coefficient. I got 2 kips here, minus 2.4445. Five looks bad, but it's supposed to be 5.5556. Okay. Again, my answer came out as positive. My assumed sense in the free body diagram is correct. And so looking at your free body diagram, what is this force? Is that a tensile force or is that a compressive force?
Compressive.
Very good. It's compressive. That was a lot of work for one joint, wasn't it? Okay. But you will come across a problem like this. Again, my preference would have been to go to joint D before B, but I decided to use this joint first in case you guys run into a problem like this in future truss analyses. Okay. So let's take a look at our truss one more time. Because we're not quite done. So here's my clean truss. We found BC, we found CD, we found AB, we found BD, we've analyzed joint B, we've analyzed joint C. We're left with joint A, joint D, and we're left with member AD. Because out of 5 members, we've already completed 4 by using just 2 joints. But for 1 remaining member, we got 2 joints left over. So you have a choice again. Do you analyze joint A or joint D? And it is, like, of course, totally up to you. But think about this. You got 1 member still remaining and you have 2 joints. So if I choose one joint over the other, then I'm still left with one joint. But I said to you at the beginning, you have to use all of your joints. What do you think the last remaining joint is will be used for?
To check it?
Yes, we're going to use it to do our check, okay? So I am going to continue with the joint analysis. And which one did I use? I'm gonna use joint D. And I'm going to reserve joint A to check my work. Okay, so again, I need to find an empty space. So let me take out my joint D. And let me start with the 4 kips before I forget. We found f sub cd, which is 0.4445 kips, and this was a tensile force. F sub bd we just found it, and this is also tensile. F sub AD is the one that we need to look for. Let me include okay. So of the four forces at joint D, three are completely known, whereas F sub AD still remains as unknown. Can you guys help me to assume the sense for this unknown force? Should it be a tensile force, or do you think it should be a compressive force?
I'm going to assume it's going to be a tensile force.
Very good. Because if you look at it, F sub AD is an X component of the force, or horizontal force, right? So if you look at the other two forces with X components, they're both moving to the right. So to keep the forces in equilibrium, it makes sense to assume that F sub AD is a tensile force. Okay, and that is the only unknown force. Even though we got two equations, it makes sense for us to use sum of the forces in the X equal to zero. So starting with F sub AD, it's moving to the left, so negative. F sub BD is moving to the right. There are three forces in the X. F sub AD is still unknown. F sub BD, we have the magnitude. F sub CD is 0.4445 equal to zero. Combining the two known forces, we can solve for F sub AD, and it comes out to 2.4445 kips. And as Dylene mentioned before, this is a tensile force because we assumed the sense to be correct. And that wasn't too painful to find. Okay. Double checking. We have five unknown forces. We found all five. But we only used up three out of four joints. So technically, we're done with this problem. But of course, you're not quite done with me because I expect you guys to show me the work for checking. Okay, good. I think everyone's done copying. So let's recap. Let me start with my you have a sub y, a sub x. Let me put those back in here for checking. Okay, so we've analyzed C, B, D. We have not used A, but we found all of these five forces completely. We found them all. You will always have an unused joint left over at the end of method of joints. And I want you guys to use that joint, whichever joint it may be, to check your work. So let me take out my joint A. I got A sub Y. We found before of 3.3 1/3. A sub X of 2 kips. f sub ad of 2.445 kips. And f sub ab, which was a compressive force. Okay, so here's my free body diagram for joint A. We're going to use the two same equations, sum of the forces in the x equal to zero and sum of the forces in the y equal to zero. And all of our forces must add up to zero. So let me start with the x. Do these forces add up to zero? So I'm going to start with my two kips, a sub x, positive. AD is 2.4445, and F sub AB is going to be negative 5.5556 times 8 over 10. Do these three forces add up to zero? And they do. Check. Do I have room below? Oh, yes, I got space. Sum of the forces in the y equal to zero. In the y, I got only two forces at joint A, A sub y, and the y component of F sub AB. So let me scroll down a bit. F sub AB. And do they add up to zero? And they do. Okay. How many pages of work did it take in your case? It took me, I got three pages. About three, right? Okay, 3 to 4, or depending on your handwriting or size, it may be less. But there's a lot of details to be included as you move from one joint to the next. So if you make a mistake with your senses and if you carry out your incorrect sense, everything falls apart. So it's absolutely important for you guys to update your free body diagram as soon as when you recognize that you've made a mistake with your senses. And I'm going to show you an example where I do make a mistake so that I can show you how to correct it. But for now, do you guys have any questions about this? I can only see a few of you, and the ones that I can see, you guys seem pretty satisfied. I don't know if satisfied, but you guys seem okay. Any questions on this problem? Bobby, how are you? Good. Okay. Okay. Very good. Then I'm going to.
I have one question.
Oh, sure. Jaehyun, go ahead.
So when you check, would you have to do that for every single joint to make sure they equal zero?
Oh, no. Only a joint that still remains as unused.
Okay.
Yeah. You will always have a joint at the end of your work that is not used in any of your work. So use that joint to check your work.
Okay.
So if you've made a mistake somewhere, this should not work out to be zero. I can guarantee you that. Because every force builds on top of the other forces. Okay, very good. Any on this? Okay. Because I was creating PowerPoint slides, I put a little bit of summary concluding the method of joints. So you guys can read these steps on your own. Basically, we've gone through these steps as part of our process, so I won't read them to you, okay? But these are there for you in case you guys forget about the process. But let me turn over to the other, I think it's this one for today. Okay, so we've done this problem here, and I want us to continue with our next method of sections. method of sections is not as straightforward as method of joins, because you have to figure out, you got to do some analytical thinking before you actually apply this method. So let me just go over the very basics of this. So sections meaning that we're going to take the entire truss and we're going to break it apart into pieces. Okay, so typically when you pass what we call a cutting plane or cut through your truss, right, we're going to divide it into two sections. So the truss is divided into two sections by passing a cutting plane through a number of members in which the unknown forces are acting. So there's got to be a strategic thinking behind this. And in this case, and this is critical, no more than three members of unknown forces should be cut through. So this is telling us that our maximum number of unknowns is limited to three, whereas in the method of joins, our limit was two. But with method of sections, we have a limit of three, okay? And the limit of three comes from the three equations of equilibrium. This is telling us that we can use Moomin's equation. That's what this is telling us. Now, when you pass a cutting plane through your truss of unknown forces, you have to decide, okay, which section do I analyze? Which one is easier and more efficient for us to analyze? And once you make that decision, isolate that section as a free body and continue with your analysis. There is no limit to how many cutting planes you're allowed to pass. Depending on the number of unknown forces, you can pass one, two, three, there is no limit to it. Same goes for your Moomin's equation, right? There is no limit to how many times you can apply the Moomin's equation, okay? So the truss will be divided into two parts by passing a cutting plane. One of the two parts will be isolated as a free body, and the procedure involved here for passing a cutting plane is through the unknown forces. So you can't just decide, oh, I want to pass a cutting plane through these members because I just feel like it. No, you have to pass a cutting plane through unknown forces. Again, no more than three unknown forces are allowed. This is the basis here. If the truss as a whole is in external equilibrium, then any part that you isolate has to be in equilibrium as well. And for the method of sections, we have all of these three equations of equilibrium to be applied. And this is really nothing new. I've covered this with you guys for the method of joints as well. So I'm so excited to share with you the next example problem. We're going to start easy and slowly. Okay, let me show you this example problem right here. So this truss, how many members do we have here? I don't know. Maybe a little bit more than a dozen. I don't know how many members we have. But luckily, I'm not asking you to analyze for every single member. But let's say that I gave you this problem and I ask you to analyze for every single member of the truss. Then you'll be first complaining that I gave you such a big problem to do. Second, you still have to do it, so you're thinking of symmetry. Can I take advantage of symmetry for this truss? Jason?
No.
Why not?
Well, on joint B, you have 1,600 pounds, and on joint F, you have 2,400 pounds.
Very good. You have symmetry in terms of its geometry, but not in terms of its loading. So Jason is absolutely right. And then you guys can conclude that I am being very mean to you because I'm not even giving you guys symmetry. But I'm going to be nice with this example. Instead of analyzing for the entire truss, I'm asking you guys to analyze only three of the members of this truss. Okay, but before we do that work, what do we need to do first? What is our step one to analyzing trusses or any structure?
Free body diagram.
Very good. Free body diagram of what? And what are we looking for with that free body diagram? Excellent answer, but I want a little bit more details here. Dailene is going to get us started, so someone else can help to answer this question. What are we looking for by using a free body diagram of this truss? Anybody? Or do I have to call on somebody? I hate calling on somebody. I'd rather have you guys volunteer. Okay, who's been quiet? I've heard from Lewis before. Jonathan, what do you think? What should we do first? We can't hear you, Jonathan. I think your mic is, no, it's. Okay, solving for A sub Y, we get 3,800 pounds. Then I'm going to take another moment about point A. Now, if we had symmetry, then I can then say by symmetry, the other reaction force should be the same, but I don't have symmetry. This time I'm just going to leave out the units. Okay, so Bailey told me to find the reaction forces, and I've done that. I should probably carry out my check because I want to make sure my reaction forces are correct before I move on. And my forces add up to zero. So I'm going to proceed with some confidence in my support reactions. Let me scroll up a bit. Okay, please look up for me when you guys are done so I can see that I can move on. Maybe we should have like a commercial breaks. Okay, good. I think we're good. Okay. Let me go back to the truss. Do I have a picture below? No, I'm gonna go back up. I don't know where I insert. I forget where I inserted that. So I'm back to my free body diagram for the truss, right? So we're done with the support reactions. We've determined that the entire truss is in equilibrium, so we're good. Now, this is the way I want you guys to do this work. It just makes it a little easier. I want you guys to take a highlighter or something, and I want you guys to highlight those members that are in question. So in this question, I'm asking you to analyze the force, not for the entire truss, but certain members only. So I'm going to take my highlighter, and I'm going to highlight the member BD. That's one of them. There are three that I'm asking you to do. CD and CE. The reason why I do this, especially when you're asked to solve for only a few, a selective few members, I want to see where they are located physically. The reason why I'm doing that is because I have to decide where to pass a cutting plane, exposing these unknown forces. So as if, you know, you're taking a pair of scissors and you got this picture in your notebook, not that I'm asking you to do this, but you're going to take your scissors and cut through these unknown members, okay? So once they are highlighted and you can see where they are, and this is an easy one because these three members are kind of all together, right? They're not dispersed throughout the truss, okay? Which makes it a little easier. Now, the next thing is I need to take a pair of scissors and cut through these members, meaning I need to identify where I should pass a cutting plane. And let me share with you that a cutting plane can be of any shape, okay? It could be a straight line, it could be a zigzag. It doesn't have to conform to any rules, as long as it's cutting through somewhere through these members. So I don't want you guys to do this, but let me just show you. If I'm passing a cutting plane, I want to make sure I am cutting through members CE, CD, and BD with just one cutting plane. So the best way, I think, is just to cut straight down, okay? Or, oh, I should not have done the dotted line. Now it's going to make it harder to erase. I'm so dumb. But you get the idea. Let me highlight these again. So I may take a cutting plane and just simply pass right through. Notice that my line is not straight, right? The point is, it doesn't matter. Can I pass a cutting plane very close to this end? Sure, I'm still cutting through my three members. I can cut through right here if I want to, or if you wanna be a little more exciting about this, you may say, well, I want to just go crazy with this. It doesn't matter. That's the whole point. As long as you're cutting through. But I'm a very simple person, so I'm just going to pass a straight line. Okay. I'm not passing this cutting plane right in the middle, right in the center of my members. It does not matter. Okay. Now, visualize this. If you're cutting through, how many sections do you end up with on the floor? How many sections of the truss do you have? Four.
Jonathan said it's four.
I don't see four. Does anybody else see a different number?
Now I changed it to.
Good answer, right?
That was my answer too.
That was your answer too, very good. Great job. Very good. There are two sections. One to the left of the cutting plane. Let me write that first here, cutting plane. You have one section of the truss to the left of the cutting plane, and you have another section to the right of the cutting plane. So you end up with two cutting planes. The next decision you need to make is this. You need to decide which side of the cutting plane you should isolate for analysis. So you got two sections. Which one do you think we should isolate as a free body and why? Oh, you were looking at the zigzag. Go ahead.
The left side.
Bobby says the left side. Why, Bobby?
There's just less things there.
Ah, okay. Very good. I like that answer. Okay. So the left side, think about this. You're going to have to redraw as a free body the entire section. So if you're like me, you want to go with the smallest first in terms of its size. So the left side is definitely smaller than the right-hand side. But more importantly is what Bobby said. There are fewer things to worry about. On the left-hand side, you have A sub X, A sub Y, and 1600. But A sub X is zero. So you don't even have to worry about this one. That means you have a sub y and 1600. Then you have the three unknown forces, right? In members BD, CD, and CE, a total of five forces. In comparison, the right-hand side of the cutting plane, it's not much bigger, but it is bigger, right? You have 2400 H sub Y, and you have 4000, in addition to the three unknown forces. So you have, what is it, five versus six. I will choose five over six. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and use the left-hand side of the cutting plane. So the next thing when you make a decision is to draw 3 body diagram of the section that you're isolating as a free body. So this is going to be the section ABC, which is the left section of the cutting plane. So with the method of sections, there are multiple places where you have to think strategically when making decisions. And when you isolate this section, it's the entire section. You cannot leave out anything. So this is at A, this is C, this is my joint B. At A, I have A sub Y of 3,800 pounds. At B, oh, I'm so dumb, I didn't do this. At B, I have 1,600 pounds coming down. Sorry, it's kind of small there, but 1,600 pounds is there. And then, to the left of my cutting plane, I got portions, sections of my three members. Okay, then I have to give names to these unknown forces. So let's take a look at the member BD at the top. So this is the force F sub BD that I am looking for in member BD. Then I got F sub CD in member CD, and then F sub CE for the member CE. Then I need to assume the senses of these three unknown forces. There are three of them. I don't know what their senses are going to be, so I'm just going to make a guess, okay? So I'm going to assume that, well, A sub Y is going up 3,800, and I got 1,600 coming down. To keep that balance, I'm going to make F sub CD because of its downward force, and assuming that force is compressive. Then I'm going to say that the force right next to it, kind of, I'm going to say to balance out the X component of F sub CD, I'm going to make that to go to the right. But then F sub BD, I don't really know, because I got three forces in the X and I really cannot figure it out. So I'm just going to assume here. Okay. And again, it is okay to assume these senses. Because math will help us. Okay, so my free body diagram is getting almost completed here, but there is this force F sub CD that's an inclined force. So I need to figure out the amount of inclination in member CD, and I need your help. What do you think I should do? So let's go back up to the truss. Do I have one below? Yeah. So let me take a look at this one here. This is cleaner. So this is what I'm looking for. the amount of inclination for the force in member CD. So I am looking for the base and the height so that I can figure out the hypotenuse. What is your suggestion that I should do?
Would you find the length of the... Okay, I can't think of anything.
Yeah, you can. What would be the length? What length can I use for this right triangle?
So your base would be 12, your horizontal is 12, vertical is 9.
Very good. Very good. I would totally use that. And this is the reason why. Sometimes students think that they should pass a cutting plane right through the midsections of the members. And proportionally, they take half of 12, half of 9. Why increase the level of complexity when it doesn't have to be, right? Just use the dimensions given by looking at this entire right triangle. We're using proportionality. We're using similar triangles anyway, right? So why complicate it when you don't have to? So use 12, 9, and therefore the hypotenuse. This is a simple triangle, 15. So very good. Let me see, where is it? Right here. So I would use C to D. So I got 12 here, 9 here. So 12 squared plus 9 squared gives you 15 squared. So the hypotenuse is 15. This is so much easier. Very good. Then a couple of things I'm going to add. My dimensions here, because we're going to be using moments with a method of sections. So it is important to have your dimensions provided. Okay, so my free body diagram cannot get any better than this because we have everything that we need to have for our free body diagram. Okay, I know we're not gonna finish, but let's take a look at what we have and where we're going with this. I have three unknown forces, F sub BD, CD, and CE. I have three equations available. Sum of the forces in the X equal to zero, sum of the forces in the Y equal to zero, and sum of the moments equal to zero. With three unknowns and three equations, can you tell me which equation would be the easiest perhaps to use first? So just like your method of joints, how many unknown forces do we have in the X? How many unknown forces in the X? Bobby, okay, so Bobby says two, but F sub BD is a horizontal force, right? So that belongs in the X. What about F sub CD? It's an inclined force. When you resolve it, you have the X component to it. And then of course, F sub CE. So for F, this one, you got three unknowns. What about in the Y? How many unknown forces do we have in the Y? Just one, very good. Okay, so you can start with sum of the forces in the Y equal to zero, or you can take a moment about a point. And since we're out of time, I will have to come back. But when you choose a moment center, you always want to eliminate as many unknowns as you can. You got only three joints here, A, B, and C. Which one do you think is an ideal moment center? Bobby? C, very good. Because at joint C, you have F sub CD, F sub CE passing right through. So two of the three unknowns are eliminated right away. Furthermore, 1600 pounds, its line of action passes through joint C. So three forces are, from the beginning, eliminated. Okay, very good. I will stop here. Don't forget, we are meeting on Monday. We're going to continue and complete method of sections on Monday. So please do show up to class on Monday, and then we'll, I guess, enjoy Thanksgiving after that. Don't forget your test corrections due by 6 p.m. on Friday. But before that, please send me your corrections and I'll be happy to check over. Very good. I'll see you next time, guys. Bye-bye.